Hey, what's up, everybody? This is your boy Kenny, and this is Triangle Season 3, Episode 16, and the name of this episode is Ghosts from the Past. Wow, this was a really good episode. I mean, the acting was superb, and the actual storylines were mind-blowing. I truly enjoyed this episode. But before I get started, I want to let you all know, subscribe to BRTBTV.com. Again, subscribe to BRTBTV.com if you have not already done so. I will have the link in the description box. Go to this site and subscribe to it right now, because this season 3 is amazing, and I'm enjoying every minute of it. And it's like every episode has you at the edge of your seat. And it's great writing, and I'm loving what I'm seeing right now. And the show is doing amazing. So, you know, definitely for those who have not subscribed to BRTBTV.com, you need to subscribe today to BRTBTV.com. So I just want to get it out the way. Also, how I'm going to do this is I'm going to try to group all the scenes together, because so much happened this episode. But if I miss anything, put it down in the comments. I'd love to talk to you about it. So let's get started with Derek. Derek, as we know from the past episode, he was actually kidnapped by Daniel, you know, the cokehead with the glasses. This episode, we open up, Derek wakes up, and he wakes up in his own bed in his own apartment. Because remember, in the last episode, Daniel used some chloroform to knock Derek out. When Derek woke up, he was back in his own apartment. So now Derek is completely shook and is literally, like, afraid, because now this crazy person knows exactly where he lives and now has access to his home. So we next see that he ends up going to Neil. He's pretty much spaced out of his mind. He's trying to explain to Neil what's going on. But you know Neil feels some kind of way, because we realized the last time that they interacted with each other, Derek broke up with him and told him that he was still in love with Rob. So Neil feels some kind of way, and he's not really fully understanding why Derek is back on his doorstep, but yet Derek looked like he's completely spaced out and out of it, as if like he's been on getting high or some shit. But he lets him know that Daniel kidnapped him, and now he's afraid to go back home. And, you know, but we can definitely tell that Neil still got some feelings for Derek, because he eventually just lets Derek stay. But after a while, he just kind of gets tired of going back and forth with him, because, you know, Derek is not really making any sense. And of course, Derek, in his typical fashion, is still like, oh, you're never there for me when I need you and all this shit. I'm like, first of all, this nigga was spending money on your ass, and he made you shrimp and grits. Bitch, he has been there for you. But you have so much shit going on, it throws him off. Hell, it throws us off as being members of the audience, Derek. So, let's be real here. You know, yeah, Neil got his shit with him too, and I'm going to get into that, trust me. But we can tell in this scene, like, he still is, like, drawn to Neil. And it's kind of funny, and it's kind of ironic that here it is, you guys just had an explosive argument, but in times of trouble, you're always going to Neil. You know, Neil, he kind of sees Neil as somewhat of a savior. But afterwards, you know, Derek pretty much passed out because he's still woozy from the drugs or whatever. And then Neil's like, you know, go ahead, man. I don't give a damn what you do. So that was the end of that. Next, we actually see that Derek goes to see Victoria, his mother. He wants a gun, but doesn't want to tell her exactly why, which puts her on the fence, because she's like, first of all, how do I know you even know how to use a gun? Well, we all know that Derek knows how to use one. Then she asks us, how do I know that whatever shit you're involved in, how do I know that this is not going to come back on my doorstep after you do something and fuck up with this gun, and then all of a sudden shit comes back on me? So, like, look, if you want a gun from me, you need to tell me everything. But Derek ain't trying to say anything. Derek is still, but you was quick to drop her name to Daniel, but you don't want to tell her what really happened to you. It's like he's trying to keep that, and I think it's because he doesn't want to talk about him being an escort. He doesn't want to give her that kind of information. But something is telling me that she's going to find out about it, so, and time will tell. And she pretty much told him that she'll think about it, and he ends up leaving. But we can definitely tell that, you know, he is still longing for his mother's love, but Victoria is still got that wall up, and for damn good reason. Now, one of the scenes that definitely stood out was the scenes involving Mason. I have to go on to say, Jason, you did a phenomenal job in this episode. Your acting was superb. I was drawn into Mason. And the funny thing about it, I see a lot of similarities with myself with Mason's character. And it was really like eye-opening to see. Well, we actually, when we first see Mason in this episode, Mason has just found out about Adonis' suicide while he's on the computer. We see that he's emotional. He breaks down. We actually see him talking to Kiko. Kiko is there for emotional support and lets him know that she's there for him and everything, and he lets her know about Adonis. And he pretty much opens up that he feels that it's his fault. But we all know that that mentality has been constructed by Jabril. You know, because remember, Jabril changed that suicide note that Adonis left. So now Mason is blaming himself for Adonis' death. And now he feels guilty when we all know that was not Adonis' plan. But Jabril is being the puppet master here. So now he's blaming himself, and Kiko's saying, you can't blame yourself, it's not your fault. He killed himself, so he did this to himself. This is not your fault, so don't blame yourself. But, you know, Mason right now is still, you know, he's still stricken by the grief of Adonis' death, and he lets Kiko know that he's going to go to see Jabril and Brandon and let them know about it. Little does he know, Jabril already knows. But Kiko said that, you know, keep in touch with me. I'll hold down the mannequin factory, but if you need me, you know, I'm here for you. We next see that he goes to see Jabril and Brandon. Jabril is being an insensitive asshole to him. Like, Brandon is literally comforting him because we can definitely see that Mason is really emotional and he's saddened by Adonis' death. Even though they ended on bad terms, he's stricken with emotion because he truly loved Adonis. And he tells him about Adonis being dead, and then all of a sudden, damn, Jabril is like, no, this is bullshit. This is bullshit. As a matter of fact, he probably died to get away from you. You know, how do I know that this ain't your fault? And he's like, you know what? I can't deal with this anymore. I'm going to go talk to his family, you know, the people who really gave a damn about him. And then we see, while he walks away, Jabril has a smile on his face. And I'm like, you Hobbesian-ass nigga. Wow. Just the sheer evil and the sheer carelessness of someone's well-being. Like, Jabril has literally stepped over to the dark side. And it's funny because later on his sister mentions that to him, like, for you to be somebody in power, I'm shocked you haven't taken a walk on the dark side. Little does she know he actually did. And I'm talking about Claudio. I'm going to get to her, though. But the fact that he did that shit, and it really upset Brandon because he's like, we need to be supportive. You know, obviously he's emotionally distraught by this, but Jabril don't give a shit. Jabril's just like, fuck him. You know, it's your fault, you know, and I'm going to go talk to his family because obviously you didn't give a damn about him, but I know his family did. And it's like, yo, it's just like he is still spinning, you know, that will to break Mason down. Afterwards, we actually see that when Mason goes back home, Mason gets an unexpected visitor, and it's his mother. And his mother is like, she, the woman who's playing his mother, she is a great actress. I mean, she really was giving me Claire Huxtable mixed with a little bit of Veronica Harrington from The Have and the Have Nots. I was kind of getting that with her. I'm not saying she's evil, but she's a woman that ain't going to take no shit. You know, she's really very strong and a very powerful woman. And, you know, to see that's where Mason gets his strength from, it was eye-opening. But yet, the two of them do not get along. You know, they have a very combative relationship. Also due to the fact that we find out that as a child, Mason was physically abused by his stepfather. And he has resentment towards his mother because he felt that his mother never defended him. His mother knew that the abuse was going on and allowed it to happen because in her mind, he was making a man out of him. Because she said, my boy wasn't going to walk around acting like no girl or no sissy. So we already got to see that's her mentality. And she thought that what her husband was doing was actually helping Mason, but it was actually destructive and emotionally and physically destructive to him. And they pretty much go back and forth, and Mason doesn't hold back, and neither does she. So they both are strong-minded people who are not going to let you have one over them. So we see that they have that in common, but man, the fight between them was crazy. And then we also meet Mason's other sister, Mercedes. She comes in. She kind of is like the referee between the two of them, but she says that I want to stay here and help support you. So she's there for him, and they talk, and then we find out some stuff about Mercedes. As Mercedes actually is in a relationship with a woman. She's an attorney. I think she's also a graduate from Georgetown University, one of the top Ivy League schools here in D.C., But then again, he also has resentment because he feels that Mercedes and Melanie were kind of like the mother's favorites because they always did what she said. And Mason, being his own person and being strong-minded and being a person that chose his passion over what was conveniently accepted, you know, as far as, you know, careers in the family, he always kind of felt like, you know, he always kind of felt like an outcast, like his mother never supported him or his mother never loved him or she was never proud of him, of his accomplishments. But look, let's be real. I mean, Mason is independent. He has his own company. He's successful right now. But, you know, it's like his mom was kind of thinking about his sexuality and him being invested in makeup. It was all a phase and that he was going to grow out of it. But no, it wasn't a phase. It's his passion, you know, and he's a great makeup artist. But, you know, he pretty much was also voicing his feelings to Mercedes. And, you know, he even got on Mercedes because Mercedes pretty much, you know, she's dating a woman, but she also has attraction to men. So she's pretty much a confused bisexual. And he's kind of letting her know, like, look, you need to know what you want to do and not be strangling this girl along. But she's like, no, it's nothing like that. You know, I really do love her and all of that. But it was cool to see Mason interact with his family, that they're there to support him. But also to let you know, and this is my hypothesis, Mason comes from a powerful family also. Because we can definitely tell how the way Mama Hawkins came up in this spot. She ain't nothing to fuck with. She is not to be fucked with. Oh, yeah, she's very bougie and very, you know, high society, but she looked like she'll fuck you up if you fuck with her kid. So, Jabril, watch your back. Just saying. Yeah. Not only do you know Jabril, Mason comes from a successful family as well. And I think later on that's going to be revealed because he definitely comes from a rich family. I mean, these damn... Both of his sisters went to Ivy League schools. Oh, that family got money. So, yeah, we're going to see what's going to happen with that. Next, the person I'm going to talk about is Christian. And Kiko only appears, like, I think, like in two scenes, but Kiko's scenes were everything. And The first scene with Christian is with Kiko, and he finally opens up to Kiko about the person that he's still in love with is Jabril, and he tells about him and Jabril's past, about them growing up together in Georgia, you know, growing up on the farm, and when they started to develop their relationship, how his family rejected it, so he chose his family over him, so he dumped him, and then later on, you know, Kenyon left town, and then on top of it, it just goes to show how much of a small world it is, because Kiko is the best friend of Jabril's husband. So now he knows that. He pretty much lets her know, like, could you please keep this between us? I'm new to Easton. I'm not trying to have no drama. I just want to do my job. But I wanted to get it off my chest. So Kiko says she keeps a secret. But little do you know, Brandon already owned you, Christian, because you got Fallon to thank for that. Because we remember a few episodes ago, Fallon did put that bug in Brandon's ear about Christian working with Jabril, and that they've been working late nights and all of that stuff. Mm-hmm. Next, we actually see Jabril and Christian talk, and they're talking about this artist, Sherry, and Neil, you know, who's supposed to be working with her. And Jabril is totally not here for it, and he's like, I can't work with him. And he was pretty much trying to put Christian on to it, but Christian's like, look, I'm going to be working on other business ventures. You're the manager of this artist, and he's pretty much the artist manager, so you two are going to have to work together around this artist. But he's like, I do not want to work with Neil. And he opens up about him and Neil's relationship. Neil was the one he dated after Christian and before Brandon. So Neil was the mean between the two extremes. And we come to find out that their relationship was rather interesting. After he left, left the Davenport family in Georgia, he went to Philadelphia and ended up getting this job at his radio station. And that's how he met Neil, because Neil was a struggling songwriter, and he kept going to the radio station trying to get his songs played on the radio. They interacted, and next thing you know, they were in a relationship. And Neil gets a business opportunity, which leads them to Easton. So we come to find out the reason why Jabril was even in Easton was because of Neil. But while they're there, they have like this alpha male type of relationship where they're trying to outdo each other. And also we find out that when he did originally leave the family, Jabril had a nest egg. So he had enough money to support himself. He didn't need the family for anything. And of course, this kind of made Neil jealous, because Neil was working his ass off, but Jabril was at home not doing nothing, but Jabril didn't have to work. He had enough money where he could lounge and not do nothing. He probably had a few million on him. Well, what ended up happening was that after a while, he began to open up with their relationship and pretty much gave Neil access to his money. And Neil took full advantage. He started to spend his money left and right. And it's kind of similar to what's going on now, because we also have the scene between Jabril and Brandon where he mentions that there's money missing from my account, you know, and Brandon's like, oh no, I had to do this for books and all of this, and I had to, and I also had some classes. So he said, okay, so just take the money from the other account and put it to that one. So it's kind of funny, like he opened up his finances to his man, kind of like what's going on right now with him and Brandon is somewhat taking advantage, but Neil went on a fucking shopping spree on Jabril's ass, because not only was he spending his money, he started to cheat on Jabril and was using Jabril's money to cheat on him with other men, more submissive men. Because, you know, they both were alpha males, so they were kind of constantly butting heads to see who was the more dominant person in the relationship. And eventually, he confronted Neil about it. Neil physically attacks him, but he breaks Neil's arm or whatever, gets away, and then the next thing you know, Neil cleans out Jabril's account. So that's why Jabril was broke and struggling around the time Brandon met him, because at the end of the day, he did have a nest egg, but Neil robbed him of his money. And then he even talks about it later on. He sees Neil like a few years after that while he's working at Indigo, and he tried to offer him some money. He said he tore the check in his face and told him that he never wanted to see him again. And he didn't see him until that night that they were having that meeting, where he realized that the songwriter that they're meeting with was Neil. So this puts, you know, this puts Christian in a space where he's like, oh, I'm going to have to handle this shit. So he goes to talk to Neil. He pretty much lets him know that you're not going to be working with the artist Sherry no more, but I got some other artists for you to work with. And, you know, and he was like adamant. He was like, oh, but I thought I could have been working with Jabril. He's like, well, actually, we're going to change that. And, you know, I'm going to have you work with these other artists, and that's what it's going to be. And, you know, we're just going to move forward. And then next thing you know, Neil was like, you know, you could have just told me the truth that Jabril doesn't want to work with me. Got all in his fucking feelings. And he's like, what the hell you mean by that? He's like, look, you know, I'm pretty sure you know about what's going on. So why don't you work it out where me and Jabril can meet with each other? Because you can definitely tell that Christian ain't for the bullshit now, because now he knows about Neil. He definitely don't like him now, and for the fact that he robbed Jabril the way he did. So he's like, look, Jabril ain't trying to work past this. He don't want nothing to do with you. So you just need to leave him be and go on about your business. But then he lets him know that, look, either you set up a meeting with me and Jabril, or I'm going to sue your ass, because I already signed contracts with the artists, you know, and Jabril is actually, you know, is on these contracts as my manager. My lawyer has a copy of this. Now, I cannot void these contracts and take your ass to court and ruin your business, because you know with an actual case like this, you know this is going to go far in the music industry. So either you do what I ask, or I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to pursue this. And Christian is not here for the bullshit, but it's like, damn, he got Christian cornered. So Christian's like, okay, I'll set something up, but yeah, me and you are done. And I'm like, see, Neil is a messy motherfucker, and we're starting to see that shit. Like, that same messiness and manipulative, you know, tactics that that Jabril has, we also see that same quality in Neil. So it's like, yeah, Neil can be a messy bitch also. So Christian goes back and tells Jabril about what went down and says that, look, I'm going to need you to meet up with him because he's not going to void the contracts and he will sue me if you don't do this. So he's like, look, I'm going to work this out, but it's messed up that he dragged you into this shit. But while this is going on, Brandon is watching. Now, it's funny because earlier, Brandon and Jabril had like a really good moment, you know, a brief moment where they, you know, kissed and made up or whatever. But this motherfucker, Brandon, was looking outside of the door and saw, you know, Christian and Jabril talking. All of a sudden, this anger and this jealousy and this rage just started to leak. And it wreaked havoc when he walked into the room. He's like, oh, well, if you guys are done, me and my husband need to have a moment. And he just goes off, what the fuck is going on here? Like, oh, so this was going on, the late nights and all this shit? Oh, yeah, you ain't going to be working with this nigga no more. And he's like, I'm putting my foot down. And him and Jabril get into it. He's like, yo, you're not going to see him no more. And Jabril's like, I ain't going to do a damn thing. As a matter of fact, why the hell you insecure? Or is there something you're not telling me, nigga? And it just kind of goes left. And I'm like, wow, so Fallon has definitely gotten to Brandon, and Brandon is letting him know that he ain't for the bullshit. But then, yeah, it also does speak for the fact that he is insecure because, one, he got a drug habit, and he's been spending Jabril's money to feed his fucking habit, and he, in his mind, still thinks that he has sex with Alex, even though it really didn't happen, but in his mind, he thinks it did because he woke up and he was in bed naked with Alex and shit. So, yeah, it's definitely that. And Yeah, so it's like, wow, you know, a still is just still trouble in paradise. And they just got married, which is crazy. Next, we actually see that, you know, Claudia comes to town to visit. And her and Jabril are kind of catching up. You know, she's pretty, and like, remember what Fallon said about Claudia. That, yeah, Claudia don't want nothing to do with the Davenport industry. She don't want to be involved with the family business, but she's very smart. And when you think she's not paying attention, she actually is. And we actually saw this in this episode, especially with her reaction to Julian, her nephew. And let's just say Julian was still serving the same old shit, pansexual slut puppy with a hot dick, because that's pretty much his MO. He definitely is always trying to find someone's weakness and trying to pounce on it. And he tries that shit with Claudia, and Claudia literally, you know, grabs him by the balls and lets him know, like, no, I'm on to you. I know you're full of shit. I know at the end of the day, you're Fallon's child. So, therefore, the apple doesn't fall too far from the tree. I know how she is, and I know you got those qualities also. And we actually see that before she pretty much called Julian out on his bullshit, and Julian was in his feelings. So he was trying to work out his manipulative tactic, because, you know, he's trying to take down the Davenport family in his own way. And I think him trying to come on to Claudia, he was trying to make some type of a twisted alliance with her, but she wasn't for the bullshit. So we actually see that before she leaves, she tells Jabril that, look, don't be so trusting of Julian, because he is a Maxwell, and I know how he was like. So keep your eyes open. But Jabril right now is like, oh, Christian's a good kid. He's like, yeah, but you need to know what you're getting yourself into. So it was cool that we had Claudia, because Claudia kind of put it out there like, look, I'm kind of letting you know something ain't right, and you need to pay attention. The last scene was everything to me, because after Derek leaves her house, Victoria, you know, is drinking and she goes to sleep. And while in her dream or nightmare, guess who she has a conversation with? Her dead brother, Victor DeLuca, Jesus' father. He pretty much goes in on her ass saying that, I'm looking down from above and I'm seeing that your life is screwed up. And she's like, there's no way in hell that your ass is in heaven. I was so here for that line. But he lets her know that, look, you need to bring in Derek. Derek is the future of our business. He's the future of our family. You need to put Derek on. And she's like, no, I don't want Derek involved in this lifestyle, because if something would have happened to Derek, I would never forgive myself. But he's adamant that, look, you put Jesus in, and Jesus really doesn't really want to be a part of the family business, so you need to bring Derek. Derek is the future, and Derek needs you, and you need him. And she pretty much wakes up, and she's like, oh, my God, I can't believe that this bastard is haunting me. So that's how the episode ended, but it was cool to see Victor kind of like as this, you know, as this voice in her mind, letting her know that she needs to bring in Derek, and she needs to kind of embrace him more. So we're going to see what's going to happen with that. But that's my review, y'all. But again, subscribe to BRTBTV.com today. Do it now and get caught up on Season 3 and Season 2, because this show is phenomenal and is groundbreaking, not just for the LGBTQ community, but it's groundbreaking as far as a great script and as far as a great production. I mean, I'm so here for the Triangle family, and I'm so here for this show. But yeah, subscribe to BRTBTV.com now. Also, subscribe to my channel. Click the bell so you can get notifications every time I drop a video. Like this video, comment on this video, and share this video. And I will be back with you guys for the next episode of Triangle. So until then, everybody, take care.